Hi everyone, welcome to the 11th video in the quantitative methods course, and in this video we'll be talking about what they call nonlinear regression. Specifically, I'll show you how to work with the Poisson regression model, which is for count variables, its extension, the negative binomial regression model, and logit models, which work with 0, 1 outcome variables, so dummy variables. Starting again by loading up our data. Unfortunately, CompuStat in and of itself doesn't have any clear count variables, so we're just going to generate one. We're going to generate a count of the number of acquisitions that the firm has done, and we're going to just assume that every 1,000 euros spent on acquisition corresponds with one acquisition. So we're generating a new variable, which is first acquisitions divided by 1,000, and then we're just going to round it up to whole numbers. And if there's any negative values for acquisition, we're going to replace that with zero. So if we just look at how this variable looks right now, this is what it looks like. So about 46,000 firms did not spend anything on acquisition, so they didn't have any acquisitions. 943 did one, 225 did two, etc. So this now is a count variable because it counts the number of acquisitions, and it's always in increments of 1 and 0 or larger, so it cannot be negative. And a Poisson model is a model that's specifically designed for those kinds of outcome variables. And the command for that in Stata is Poisson. This Poisson refers to the distribution that it uses. And we're going to regress the new count variable on cache, and we're going to include year dummies with robust standard error. So I would also advise you to estimate those for these kinds of models. So let's run this, and then what you see, it takes a little bit longer because these models are a little bit more advanced, and we see a coefficient for cache. However, as we will have discussed in class also, this coefficient in and of itself doesn't mean as much anymore because now we have a nonlinear model, and I'll show you exactly why it's nonlinear very soon. So rather than focusing too much on this coefficient, let's estimate the effect or the predicted count across the range of our cache variable, which you might recall runs from -0.04 up to about 423,000. Let's calculate the predicted number of acquisitions across this range. It takes a little bit longer again because this is a more complex model. But what we're going to get is, given a value of cache, how many acquisitions are predicted to take place. And if we plot this, you can maybe see right away why we call this a nonlinear model. Because as you can see, the slope of this line changes depending on the value of cache that you fill in. Specifically here, it seems like cache has an exponential effect on the number of predicted number of acquisitions. So firms with very little cache, so anything between 0 to 100,000, they tend not to do acquisitions to start. But the more cache firms get, increasingly more acquisitions tend to take place. So this is why they call this a nonlinear model. The variables are still linear. Acquisition is still a kind of untransformed variable, as well as cache. We didn't do anything with cache. However, the effect of cache on the predicted number of acquisitions changes depending on which value of cache we plug into the model. So we can also interpret these effects using two different things. One is what they call the marginal effect at the average, and the other is the average marginal effect. The average marginal effect is the more sophisticated one, and thankfully Stata can calculate this quite easily. And you can just get this by specifying margins dy dx ch, so similar to what we've already been doing. And this here, it's a very small number, is the average marginal effect. So here it would be 0.00776, highly significant. So this shows evidence that there is a positive effect of cache on the number of acquisitions that a firm engages in. Just to show you, you can get also this average marginal effect at specific values of cache, and it will be slightly different because the marginal effect depends on the value of cache that you fill in. In practical terms, I would just estimate the average marginal effect. So that's the first command that we ran here. You can also get the marginal effects at the averages. That's what you get here. If you add the options add means to this margins command, you will have Stata filling in the average for every single one of your variables. So in this case, it was cash, and it was all these different year dummies. And you can see here it fills in the average value for these dummies. This is not meaningful in a lot of ways because you cannot have a year, a 2010 dummy of 0.142. It's always either 0 or 1. That's also why I would always advise you to estimate this line that I select here, the average marginal effect. That's the most meaningful one. Several years ago, there was papers recommending to do this average or marginal effect at the averages. That's because back then computers and laptops didn't have the required computing power. Nowadays we do. So there's basically no reason to not do this. There's no reason to do this at means. But still, it's possible in Stata if you want to. Moving then on to this negative binomial regression model, it's an extension to the Poisson model, which addresses one of the assumptions that it makes, specifically that the conditional variance of the outcome variable is the same as the average, and that's quite often not the case. And the way to check whether this assumption holds or not is by running the NBREG, so negative binomial regression model, without standard robust standard errors. So let's do that. And it's going to find or calculate a specific test statistics that will provide evidence whether or not you need to run a Poisson regression model or a negative binomial regression model. That's this bottom line that I selected here. If this is significant, it provides evidence that you need to run a Poisson, a negative binomial regression model. If it's insignificant, it's better to run a Poisson model. So here, clearly, it's very significant. So we should actually run negative binomial regression. And now that we know this, we then run the same model, but now with robust standard errors. Because as you will see here, once it's done, it will show no longer this test, because this test cannot work, cannot be calculated with robust standard errors. Still, the interpretation and the next steps that you should do are the same as what we've done just now. So in order to interpret the effects of cash, I would again just run this average marginal effect, and you get this number here. And it's clearly not significant in this case. So in this case, it seems that cash does not have a significant effect on the number of acquisitions, even though this coefficient is highly significant. So that's how you can estimate models for count data. I'm also going to show you the logit model, which is specifically used for 0-1 outcome variables. So let's generate a new variable that simply tracks whether firms spend anything on acquisitions. Let's call it any AQC. Let's have it be 0 if acquisitions is not missing, because of course a missing observation, we don't know what that should be. And we're going to replace that with 1 if the acquisitions variable is missing and if the acquisitions variable is larger than 0. So if we tabulate this one, you see it's either 0 or 1. So this is the dummy variable. We have 48,000 observations for it. The logistic regression model, or logit regression model, command for that is logit. And we're going to put in this dummy variable as the outcome variable, cash, and year dummies. And we're just going to run it with robust standard errors right away. A similar story to the Poisson and the negative binomial. This coefficient in and of itself doesn't say too much. It shows there's a positive effect, but not much more. And just to show you how the distribution of this these predictions works, let's calculate again the margins, so the predicted probability in this case that there is an acquisition or not. So it's going to be between 0 and 1 because it's a probability for cash across the whole range. So we're going to get, again, like we had with the Poisson, a large number of predictions, and we're going to plot that. This takes even longer because it's also a quite advanced model. But this is what the predicted probability, that's what you see on the y-axis, is across the range of cash. So we see here that when cash is 0, the probability that a firm engaged in any acquisition is about 25-26%. So that's what you also see here, and on the left-hand side as well. You see here it's kind of almost like a straight line here, but it tapers off the higher it gets. So in this case, it seems to be a somewhat diminishing effect. It will never go over 1, and it will never go below 0. So again, this is nonlinear in the sense that the effect, or the slope of cash, so the marginal effect of cash, is going to depend on exactly which value of cash you plug in. again, just to show a little bit more how this looks, if we fill in very extreme values of cash, so from minus 1 million, 10 million, up to 10 million, this is what it looks like. So here you can really clearly see that the model prediction will never exceed 1 and will never go below 0. So again, similar to Poisson, similar to negative binomial regression, similar to all these other nonlinear regression models, the easiest way to interpret it is just to calculate the average marginal effect, and that's what you get here. And in this case, it's actually significant. So this shows that there's a positive effect, albeit quite small, of cash. So a 1 unit increase in cash is going to be associated with this much change in the probability that a firm engages in an acquisition. So it's quite small in this case, also because our cash variable is quite large in terms of its range. And as before, you can again calculate also the marginal effect at the averages, but I wouldn't do this. So this line here and this average marginal effect is what you need to conclude whether or not there is an effect of cash. Had our hypothesis been that there's a positive relationship of positive effect of cash on the probability that a firm engages in an acquisition, then indeed here we would conclude, yes, that's supported. So this is just three examples of nonlinear regression models. There's others like what they call probit model, Tobit model, etc., etc. The basic steps that I've shown here are exactly the same for all these different kinds of models. So that's really nice. So Stata is quite flexible in terms of the models that it can do, as well as the specific steps that you need to do to interpret the model. So that's a key benefit in my eyes of Stata. So essentially now you can do regressions for nearly any sort of outcome variable that you want. Thanks for watching, and in the next videos I'll talk about how to do moderation in these kinds of models. I look forward to seeing you there.